would have had overwhelming support, but there would have been a lot more debate on exactly who's going to be eligible for these. And my hope is that Nebraska will get its share. My guess is it's going to be for hardcore urban settings where the schools have much more difficulties than we do. So I'm hopeful we'll get our share. I'm just not totally confident in that. So at this point, that concludes the three speakers' remarks. And now, Roger and Marilyn, unless you have additional thoughts to pass on, do you, before we open it? Let's take questions. And since the microphones that are wireless don't work, just yell. And Greg, by the way, Greg Long is works on my staff. He is a educator, not because he schools me, but we stole him away from Bryan High School's government class. He interned with us for a semester, for the summer, as a government teacher. We like when and he stayed. We could not make him leave. All right, maybe we did make an offer. Oh, all right.
Does this work?
All right, so who's first? No one? We're adjourned. Okay, we have luck. Oh, no.
Thank you for being here, and I appreciate you guys coming and giving us this information. I was a little nervous. I wanted to be prepared because I know you're an ex-debater, and so I was not going to mess this up. And you guys were very eloquent in your definitions. As you know, money that is contained in the federal stimulus program has an unbelievable amount of money, and we're hoping it heads to the Nebraska school districts. Representative Terry, you voted against the stimulus package. For the next federal budget, NEA is working on building these funds next year's budget. Would you put it on the top of the stimulus funding?
I will pass that on to those making the decisions a little further down from the Capitol. But I express my opinions about how much of that Nebraska ultimately be eligible for. Marilyn, Roger, what discussions have you had about the requirements for these grants?
Well, the race to the top has been on our working agenda since last March, and today, ironically, the actual application and the request for proposals was sent out via email and posted on the public register. It is a 102-page application form with a 700-page addendum. So I have it in my folder, I guess it's in my car, hoping somebody will steal it. But otherwise, that's what I'll be reading tonight. But we have worked on, with working teams in the department, under the basic premise, what we would like to think about anyway, is to apply for funding to create in the state of Nebraska a support system for schools, districts, where there is demonstrated need. That would include the four reform areas, because you're gonna have to address the four reform areas. You can't pick and choose amongst them. They have to be addressed and they have to be integrated. But then also add to that, hopefully, some innovative things that would be valuable to the state of Nebraska. So, you know, to your concern, yes, we are going to apply. We are in the low tier of states in that of $4.35 billion, they estimate that our share should be somewhere between 20 and 75 million. We would disagree with that number. We don't think it should be 4 billion. but we would take that. But we think we probably should be more in the 200 million range. Now, that sounds like a lot of money, but that's over 4 years, and that's for an education system in the state that has 300,000 students. So it is, when you break it down in that way, not a great deal of money over time. The difficult issue will be in sustaining anything initiated under that particular process. And the other thing to remember about the race to the top money is 50% of the money off the top goes to districts through the Title I formula that agree to participate and use that money for the purposes of the grant. So you'll be hearing more about this as it evolves fairly soon. The first round grant applications are due in January.
Well, and I'd just to assure you that one of the things that I get to do is occasionally if they need help or help with supporting the grant by letters or whatever, your grants requests. We do that all the time in our office on a variety of different issues, and I'd be blessed if I could help with this too. James. Okay. I don't have any of those, but.
I want to follow up on the stimulus package issue just a little bit. Nebraska's already seen lots of benefits initially from this in terms of saving teachers jobs, innovative programs in this particular district, some special education programs we could have done without the stimulus package. And I wonder if you could identify what concerns you had in voting against that to trump those educational benefits.
$875 billion with interest, $1.2 trillion, you're talking about 1% of the entire package. If that was put together in an education package, as I mentioned, it would have passed overwhelmingly with a great deal of our support. But every balance, or every bill has a balance, and boy, that was a very small part of what was supposed to be a jobs growth in the private sector bill. So that was misplaced in a stimulus bill. It should have been done as an education bill.
Did they give you a whole list?
No. This one I last year, when you interviewed the NSCA, the second congressional district endorsement, you advocated an idea of paying certain teaching areas more, science and math in particular, as a recruiting tool, because those are traditionally difficult areas, especially in the secondary schools. That would not take into account, you know, merit pay or necessarily educational background or years of experience, which of course are the indicators which indicate salary under most present systems. Wouldn't that create somewhat of a divisive environment for teachers if some people come in just because at a higher level just because they happen to be certified?
Well, yeah, and it was a great discussion there. But if private sector needs specific people with high skills in certain areas, they have the flexibility to pay them more and therefore hire them and retain them. That's one of the problems that's facing education today as we move to a necessary, both the Bush administration and the current president's administration says that we have to be more competitive in a high-tech global economy. Therefore, science, engineering, mathematics is all going to have to be a bigger component of our education. And so I don't know how a district can hire a high-level physics teacher for senior high when they can double theirs by working at a company in Bellevue if you don't have some level of flexibility. So I'm trying to be creative and throwing ideas out there that would help meet the goals that we want to move to. And I don't I would hope it wouldn't create divisiveness, but that's part of the discussion that has to occur.
There's about three things I guess I would mention with regard to that question, which is a good question. One is that has happened before. In fact, the original ESEA Act offered a tuition reduction for each year a science teacher, trained science teacher, taught in the state from where they got their degree. And the reason, the rationale for that, if you remember the era of Sputnik, was the fear that the Russians were advancing far greater in space technology than we were, and we needed scientists, we needed researchers, and so there was an incentive put in that. So, and I don't think that created, I wasn't teaching at that time, I was in school, but I don't think that created a disincentive for other teachers, but that was different than, you know, a reward, if you will, for picking a particular area. But we're going to be pressed on this particular issue in the race to the top, because what they call STEM, science, technology, engineering, mathematics, is a priority criteria of projects within a race to the top grant application. In other words, you're going to have to somehow address how you're going to enhance not only the STEM opportunities for students, but the attraction support of STEM teachers. And again, we have school districts in Nebraska right now that are crying out for us to do this as a state because they can't attract a quality physics teacher, a quality upper level calculus math teacher. So, you know, we're going to have to somehow incent teachers to not only get those areas of endorsement, but also to move to those areas. In the absence of that, we have to think about a virtual school where high-quality teachers could go through online courses and deliver that instruction wherever a child might be in the state, and thereby optimize talented, highly qualified teachers. So, several options.
And I just
want to
support that, and I wanted to add to my comments of Congressman Terry, as he looks at reauthorization and even our race to the top. I think states like Nebraska, even though we're sitting in the urban part of the state tonight, I have this perspective because I deal with the districts all across the state. And we have, states with rural schools have unique needs. You know, the technology is going to be an answer for some of them. And I think the flexibility, and those are things you have supported in the past, and we'll certainly need that support in reauthorization again, because we, you know, you're talking about science and math teachers. You know, one of the effects of having state standards in 2000 when we introduced them was to take a look at what every district offered in math. You know, the way we did, STARS did, said here are the standards, you have to unpackage them, you have to identify what it is you're teaching and compare that to, in other words, what your curriculum is, compare that to what you expect kids to know and be able to do. And you know, a lot of people gasped because math and science were not close to what the standards were. You know, it was one of the biggest ahas in the state. And our first data collection indicated that a lot of schools did not offer sufficient math. Many of them were small and rural, and they didn't have sufficient teachers. It is an issue in our state, maybe not so much in this part of the state, but it certainly is in our rural areas. And we're not going to get there without the kinds of, we're not going to give those children the opportunity. You know, most of the schools you go to offer advanced placements. Some of them are international baccalaureate. You know, it takes specialized trained staff to offer those, and that's not available outside of the bigger cities. You know, our small schools don't have those opportunities. But distance learning and current technology can help that. So I think that's a critical piece we need to remember, that you know, the city of Los Angeles, the school district of Los Angeles, has over 700,000 kids in it. You know, the state of Nebraska has 300,000, and we have three districts that have about 100 kids. It's not because they want to be small, if that's all the children there are. So, you know, it is, we have to take those things into account when we're talking about opportunity to learn. Do those kids have the same opportunity to learn? And so finding teachers is a big issue that have math and science and be able to support them. And so I wanted to say that.
Next.
What is your reaction to the report that was in the paper yesterday, the state report card, and which of those factors are things that we really need to be concerned about?
Well, I don't have, I had a copy of that article somewhere around. The first blush of that, whenever I see an organization that's grading, I always say, okay, show me your criteria. What are you making these decisions on? And I don't think the article went into enough depth for me to really understand what their criteria was. If you're asking what really stood out to me was the fact that you had the Chamber and the Center for American Progress. So you had two ideological opposites working together on this one. But anytime I see something like this, even though I'll question the criteria, I think we need to step back and say, well, what's the point? What should we take from this? And it looks like on the management side of the grade, I'll pass that to Roger. He's only been there since March.
But I have an opinion. Joe's back here, and I know Joe and I did not connect, and Joe did give me an opportunity to speak about this, but I simply had not seen it and was not able to comment before it made the paper, so I'll make my comment now, Joe. The department is aware of this report and rejects its process and its conclusions. It's pretty easy to select criteria and unrelated to an institution's central purpose. And the central purpose of the public schools is student learning. And then arbitrarily grade the institution if the intention is to get headlines and to further a private agenda that has already concluded that public schools are a failure. I offer for you consideration of this one fact. The report gives Nebraska an F in terms of pipeline to post-secondary, that is, preparing students to be ready for college. The report uses old advanced placement data and dual enrollment program data as indicators. That data that they used is 3 or 4 years old in Nebraska. Why, one might ask, did the report not use the performance on the ACT test, a test taken by over 70% of Nebraska seniors? The sole purpose of the ACT test, is to measure readiness for college work. Nebraska students as a group had the highest score in the nation on the ACT of the states where at least 70% of the seniors took the test. If that is not an indication of cherry-picking your data to make the point, I don't know what is. The groups behind this report have already reached the conclusion that they believe the education system needs to be reinvented using their self-selected, unresearched, unsubstantiated innovations. The U.S. Chamber of Commerce might be well advised to look after its own house with its rampant corporate mismanagement, unethical practices, and failed, if not fraudulent, business practices before helping the nation's public schools. Thank you for that opportunity to get that off my chest. Thank you.
Joe, that's what I would have said had we talked.
Well, I think we perceived the highlight of this event.